Do you know what are conditions and what are warranties? Do you know the difference between the berth charter party and a port charter party? Or do you know what is ship owner's implied terms and charter's implied term? In this video, we'll be going to check out these terms. Hey guys, Akash here from Shipscope, bringing you the best platform to learn about the commercial shipping subjects. In the previous Chartering 101 series, we have seen about the basics of chartering, we have seen the chartering process, we have seen some additional terms used in chartering. In this lecture, we'll be focusing upon the legal terms used in chartering. If you're new here, consider subscribing it at any point of the video. Also check out the notes and links in the description below. If you like my content, guys, you can always head to my website and get the whole content downloaded. The whole content is the comprehensive lecture slides which I'm going to cover. It even consists of past ICS papers, and I have already solved some of the question papers too, and my own lecture notes, so which will help you to understand this subject more. Hi guys, welcome to lecture number 4 in Chartering 101. Today's content, so we're going to study charter parties. We'll be looking into what condition warranties are, frustration, ship owner's implied terms, charterer's implied terms, claims, equitable set-off, LOP, and berth charter party and port charter party. As we know, what are charter parties? It's a contract which gives the responsibilities, rights, and demands between the principals, which is charterer and ship owner. Now, that contract consists of stipulated terms, implied terms, special terms, and other special terms on a case-by-case basis. So let's look a bit deeper. Now, the first topic which we're going to study is condition and warranties. So what are these? Condition, an important contractual term that goes right to the root of the contract, and so fundamental that breach of it by a party would frustrate the whole contract and make further performance impossible, giving the injured party right to cancel the contract and sue for damages. So this is very, very important. If any breach happens in condition, the principals, the party can cancel the whole contract. The brief recap of what has been agreed during the negotiation in this position and firm offer stages. They represent fundamental terms of the charter party whose non-performance may allow the other party to cancel the deal. Now, what are warranties? Warranties are the contractual terms less essential than a condition, such that its breach will not have the effect of giving the injured party the right to cancel the contract, although he may be able to sue for damages. The majority of terms in most contracts are warranties rather than conditions. They represent important terms whose non-performance give the right to the other party that seek compensation. Now, what are intermediate terms, which are warranty or conditions on case-by-case basis? Now, let's look a bit deeper what exactly conditions are. Now, conditions. The most common conditions are the ship's whereabouts at the time of the charter party agreement, where it is, the time for sailing to the load port, the ship's nationality, again, one of the most important for conditions, the ship's capacity for the specific cargo, other conditions that may be set by the charter when giving its order to the market, or the ship's age, ship's clock. If any breach happens in this, the charter has the right to, you know, cancel the whole fixture, the whole contract. Okay, that is what the conditions are. Again, one more thing is criteria in relation to the ship operator and manager depending. Now, what are warranties? Primary refers to the agreed ship performance criteria and the way of compensating owners and charter in the events of default. It can be about ship speed. It can be about fuel. Fuel is again one of the most important factors, as we know. What are the rates of loading and discharging at the load port, discharge port, environmental influences, the crew's behavior, the cargo characteristics. See, I'll give you an instance where ship speed is taken into consideration. Is, let's say in the charter party, it is stipulated as that, you know, the vessel can proceed in a loaded condition for 13 knots with a consumption of 30 metric ton of IFO. Yeah, that is what is written. But as you know, I mean, if let's imagine that the fixture is fixed between the time and where the charterer is paying the fuel cost here, and in that case the charterer comes back that, you know, I'm not able to get that specific speed, or I'm consuming too much bunkers just to get that speed. So, you know, that doesn't quantify that, you know, the parties can't break the whole contract, but he or she can sue the owner for damages. That it was, you know, that is where the charter has to, you know, contact the ship owner that he's not able to get it, where a ship owner might get the deck logbook, which is on the bridge of the ship, that, you know, each and every hour it's recorded what is the speed, then oceanic currents and other factors will be taken into consideration. There can be various factors that if you're not able to get that speed. So again, not getting into details here, that is how one of the warranties is for the ship's speed. Again, for fuel remain on board delivery, rate loading, discharging, actually can't, I mean, it depends upon, you know, it can go up, it can go down. So the parties can sue for damages, but they can't cancel the whole contract. Frustration is again, guys, one of the most really good topics. So now, first we need to understand what frustration is. Frustration of a charter party is a change of condition so radical that accomplishment of a commercial object of the charter is made impossible. When an unexpected event completely deprives the parties to a charter of an essential precondition to their performance, the charter may be declared dissolved and the other parties relieved from the further performing it. Such an event is typically a permanent loss of use or destruction of the vessel. So this is where the frustration happens. Okay, there are three basic elements in order to, you know, get this frustration right, in order to prove that it's a frustration, in order to apply the doctrine of frustration. The first one is, the event given rise to the claim must be totally unexpected and unforeseeable. So you don't know what is going to happen. It's completely out of the blue. The second one is, the risk of the event must not be provided for, either by the language of the charter party or by the... And the third one, the performance of the contract must be impossible or commercially impracticable. Okay, so if these three conditions do happen, then only we can apply the doctrine of frustration. Now let's look, since we are going to have a legal aspects in this lecture, so let's look at one of the case studies which happened. So one of my favorite case studies with regard to frustration is the Super 7-2. So let's see what happened in this. So the first one is the facts. So we have a claimant here, and then there's an owner. Okay, so the claimant is this one. The claimants were the owners of an oil rig, and the defendants were the person who was supposed to transport the whole oil rig from Japan to Rotterdam. Under the terms of the contract, the defendants were able to transport the oil rig using one of the either two ships known as the Super Servant 1 or the Super Servant 2. They had the right to choose which they want to get the rig transported, either by a Super Servant 1 or the Super Servant 2. The defendant to use the second ship, as they used the second ship because the first ship was being used by the other contract. In July 1981, the Super Servant 2 was sunk in Zaire near the Congo region and while transporting the other rig. Now, what happened is the defendant argued that the contract has been frustrated as they were incapable of transporting the drilling rig. And the claimant argued that the impossibility of performing the contract had been self-induced. That's therefore they should not be discharged or need to perform this contract. Now, again, the defendant was trying to go with the help of frustration, and that's why he couldn't make it happen. And the claimant is trying to prove that he's suing the defendant for the damages. So what exactly happened in the end was, what was the ruling? What did the judge say? The court of ruled that the defendants could not rely on the doctrine of frustration, and that the defendants would have to bear the additional cost of the transportation of rig. This is what the final verdict was. Now we'll be studying about the implied terms. Now, what is an implied term? It is a term which is not written in the contract, but we have to comply or adhere with it, even if it's not written. So what are these things which are there in the contract, which are not written, but they have to be complied as? To provide the ship that is seaworthy and cargo-worthy for the duration of the voyage from the ship owner's behalf or the charterer's behalf. Not to place the ship and its crew in danger. For the ship to reach the load port with reasonable amount of time, to perform the voyage without any delays. For the ship to perform the voyage without delays, as we did this, deviations allowed due to weather conditions and safe. So now, normally it is standard practice that the ship is supposed to reach the discharge port as soon as possible. But in case of adverse weather conditions or to save human life, you can deviate. To have the knowledge and abide by the local and international laws and regulations. To set safety as a priority. most priority, which these are all implied terms. The charter may claim compensation for a deviation from the implied terms if you're trying to go away from the implied terms, or the agreed terms of the ship's performance, as we discussed earlier, that how a charter can claim under the time charter party because he's paying the variable cost, and if the ship is not meeting the desired criteria as per the charter party, they can claim for compensation. The owner may claim compensation for delays during loading and unloading because this is taken care by the charterer. Rate of loading and discharging, that is different to what has been agreed in the form of a pollution, cargo shortage. A charter party should also include methods for arranging the compensation on case by case basis. There's one more concept which I would like to discuss with you, is the equitable set off. What is an equitable set off? Charter parties may contend express rights for charterers to make a deduction from hire directly. So they can actually cut the hire from the ship owner. For example, off hire claims or deductions for the owner's disbursement. Where the charterer have a claim in damages, it may be possible to make a deduction from the hire if the charterer can establish that they are entitled to make the deduction by the equitable set off. I'd like to discuss some of the cases, but I'll just give you a brief overview of what happened in the Aditya Vaibhav case. Was the charterers claimed owners that they had breached the contract because the vessel was supposed to go towards the port, but it didn't clean the vessel holds. Due to that, the vessel got delayed and there were various expenses. Now, the charter made the equitable set off from the time lost and their consequent losses. What was the judge verdict? I'd like you guys to read about it. You can always Google it and you will come to know what happened. Similar case happened in Nafri as well and the Dominic. I mentioned the link here, so you can always go to the link and read about it. And let me know in the comment section below if you find any difficulty, because what I feel is, guys, understanding these subjects are one thing, but once you understand these subjects and try to apply it and try to understand the legality of it, why these clauses are phrased in certain way, or what has really happened, so that will make you understand the subject very well if you understand the legality part of certain topics. So this is what the equitable set off is. We are heading into letter of protest. What is a letter of protest? A written communication recording dissatisfaction on the part of the one party concerning any operational matter over which the recipient of the other party has control, and holding the other party responsible for any consequences of the matter being complained about. So normally LOPs are given by the ship's captain, and I'll show you how it looks like, and when it is given, what all different LOPs are. Most commonly, a protest is connection with the cargo, although one may be written about any matter. It may help to substantiate a claim by owner, and may prove useful if properly filed when dispute is being resolved long after the relevant event. So this is how the LOP looks like, guys. So there is a name, letter of protest, we have port, berth, from the master, what is the void number, when it is happening, and what the subject is about. It states delays between the arrival, NOR, and commence loading. So this is how the wording goes. Your faithfully, the captain of the ship signs. Similarly, we have one more LOP here where we do mention, this is normally a standard format, but things might vary. And this LOP is between the delays in berthing and commencing the cargo operation. This is how it looks like. So we have, I've made a list of LOPs, what LOPs can be and how it looks like. I've already put the downloadable material in my website. If you guys are interested, you can always go there and get it downloaded, and you can understand by yourself that, what all different LOPs are and how the things are, how the wording is stated. So you'll understand it. The last topic with which we are going to finish today's topic is the berth charter party and the port charter party. The berth charter party. The first contractual destination of the charter ship is a berth designated by the charter within the named port. Secondly, the ship, in order to qualify as an arrived ship. Now, arrived ship, when does that happen in case of berth charter party? Is when it enters the berth. So, and therefore entitled to give the notice of readiness to discharge must unless the charter party otherwise provides have reached the berth. Once the ship has reached the berth, then they can, you know, give, they are entitled to give NOR and ready to begin the discharging operation. NOR is notice of readiness, guys. We'll look into all of these concepts as we go ahead. So that is what the berth charter party signifies. Under these terms, charter party, the ship will only become an arrive ship if she has reached a particular berth. So this is more important, not the port, guys. It's the berth, because it's the berth charter party. That means the charter has to specify which berth it needs to proceed. That is expressly named the charter party. Even in the case of berth charter party, the risk of delays can be passed to charter. How can we do that? By adding this term called as vibon, which is whether in berth or not. The whole concept, why we take all of this into consideration, is we need to calculate how much lay time is consumed. So it's charged with NOR. We will be looking into this as we go ahead, but I'm just giving you a taster session here. So again, with the help of vibon, you can actually commence the lay time earlier in case of berth charter party. The latter would shift the risk of delays due to the condition of the charter. Now, again, let's look into the port charter party. First, the contractual destination of the charter ship is a named port rather than a berth. Now, in this case, you have to name a port. Secondly, the ship, in order to qualify as having arrived at the port at immediately an effective disposition of charters, and therefore entitled to give NOR, must satisfy these two conditions. When it has arrived and it is ready to discharge the cargo, that is where it is, you know, this is where the two ticks comes in. If the charter party indicates as a particular port, then the ship becomes an arrived ship even if she cannot proceed immediately to the berth, but has reached the position within the legal and administrative fiscal limits of the port, and as per Lord Reed, you know, where she is at the intermediate and affected disposition of the charter. So again, guys, I mean, I know these are two different things, berth charter party and port charter party, and there have been many instances and many disputes that when did actual lay time start, you know. So then the judge goes into, you know, the charter party, whether it was a berth, whether it was a port. So things do take a toll. That is why you can notice nowadays the load ports and the discharge ports have one safe port, safe berth. Or safe port, safe berth, is that's how it's written. That is where it came in from. We'll be looking into all of these topics in depth as we go ahead.
Do you have any recommendation for the video? Let me know in the comment section below, guys. And if you like the video, hit the like button. So thanks for checking out the video. Consider subscribing it if you haven't already. In the next lecture, we're going to see about the charter party form and some relevant clauses which we are going to use in it. Until next time, ShipScope is trying to bring you the one of the best platforms to learn about the commercial shipping subjects. Try to learn as much as possible, and we will talk soon.